A powerful force has begun to rise in central Japan, and its coming heralds the dawn of a new age of unification in the land of the rising sun. Join me today on the third episode of Japanese History, The Textbook, as we discuss the legendary Yamato Kingdom and delve into a myth-shrouded era to explore the origins of kanji, Buddhism, and the office of emperor itself on the Buyuden Japanese History Channel. Hello everyone, and welcome back to Japanese History, The Textbook, the series where we make our way through the history of Japan using educational materials made for Japanese public school students as our guide. In addition to our usual sources, the middle school reference book, Gakken Nyūkōsu Chūgaku Rekishi, and the general history primer, Teimabetsu Dakara Rikai ga Fukamaru Nihonshi, from this week I will be adding the book, Shin Moichiro Yomu Yamakawa Nihonshi. This book is published by the company Yamakawa, which publishes the widely used high school history textbooks, Nihonshi A and Nihonshi B, and this book markets itself as a high school level history textbook, slightly retweaked for adults. I will also be incorporating a small amount of information from the book Chou Bijuwaru Nihon no Rekishi Daijiten, a fun and colorful book which is obviously marketed towards children, but was actually compiled under the supervision of a Japanese history professor at Kokugakuin University, and boasts a thorough bibliography of sources. I think these two new volumes will bookend our sources nicely, with the former helping us dive a little deeper into the subject matter, and the latter providing us with the important human stories that are the cornerstone of the historical narrative. Alright, with that housekeeping out of the way, let's jump on in. Japanese History, The Textbook, Episode 3, The Kofun Period. With the final mention of Queen Iyo of Yamatai in the latter half of the 200 CE, Wakoku, or Japan, disappears from the Chinese historical records for more than a century. However, beginning right around this time, large tumuli, or burial mounds, began to be built around the Kinki region of central Japan and around the coast of the Seto Inland Sea. In contrast to Yayoi period burial customs, wherein many people would be buried in a shared graveyard, these new tombs were large structures built to inter a single high-status person. By the end of the 6th century CE, these burial mounds stretched all the way across the Japanese archipelago, housing the kings and local power holders who had reigned during this period. These tumuli are called kofun, literally old tomb in Japanese, and the period between the end of the 3rd century and the beginning of the 7th century CE in Japanese history has thus been dubbed the kofun period, or kofun jirai. Corresponding with the start of this era, a political force known as the Yamato government, Yamato Seiken, began to form as a loose coalition of gozoku, local power holders, in the central region of Japan, around the location of the modern prefecture of Nara. You may remember from our previous video that this region is also known as the Kinki region. The ultimate power holder situated at the top of the Yamato government was known as the Ōkimi, literally Great King, an office that would, over the centuries, morph into the position of Emperor of Japan. It must be noted, however, that at the Yamato government's outset, this Great King was simply the most powerful gozoku in the coalition, rather than the Tenno God Emperor that he would later become. Interestingly, the Yamato government used to be referred to as the Yamato Chōtei in older Japanese textbooks, with Chōtei meaning imperial court, and the Yamato portion of the name being written in Chinese kanji characters. However, due to the Yamato kanji not appearing in historical documents until the 8th century CE, and the fact that the Yamato government was initially a king-led coalition state, it has come to be called Yamato Seiken or Yamato Ōken in modern textbooks, with Seiken meaning government or administration, Ōken meaning kingship, and Yamato being written in the phonetic katakana characters rather than in kanji. By the beginning of the 4th century CE, the Yamato government had conquered the majority of the Kinki region, and from there they gradually began to expand their influence across the rest of the archipelago. It is thought that by the middle of the 5th century, they had built a kingdom that stretched from Kyushu in the west to the Kanto region in the east, incorporating all of the theretofore independent gozoku power holders of those regions into their governing mechanisms. The legendary Japanese hero, Yamato Takeru no Mikoto, is thought to be an amalgamation of the various war heroes who contributed to the success of these conquests. To manage the various conquered gozoku, the Yamato government began employing a system known as the Shisei system, or Shisei Seido, between the 5th and 6th centuries CE. The Shi in Shisei is the same kanji used in modern Japanese to mean something like Mr. For example, when the Japanese news is talking about US President Joe Biden, they will call him Biden Shi when they want to say Mr. Biden. The Sei in Shisei is the same character that refers to one's family name in the modern language. The Shi can also be read as Uji, and under the Yamato government's Shisei system, this Uji referred to a clan of Gozoku who operated as a unified collective with belief in a shared ancestry among themselves. To the leaders of these Uji, the Yamato government would then bestow a Kabane, an antiquated reading for the Sei character, which was a title indicating that Uji clan leader's rank and status, and sometimes also their job duties within the Yamato administration. To sum everything up, the Uji, or Shi, was the clan group itself, and the Kabane, or Sei, was the title that Uji's patriarch received, indicating his, and by extension his clan's, rank and role within the Yamato government. The most powerful Uji clans operating at the center of the Yamato government fell into two main categories. The first and foremost of these were the old clans, such as the Katsuragi, the Heguri, and the Soga, who took their names from the regions of central Japan in which they were based and received the Kabane title of Omi, indicating some kind of blood relation to the royal family. The second group were those such as the Ootomo and the Mononobe, whose clan names were based on their duties within the government, and who received the Kabane title of Muraji. A single figure from each of these groups would then be selected to participate directly in the policy-making affairs of government, with the appointee from the Omi being called the Oomi, and the appointee from the Muraji known as the Omuraji. These posts were essentially the forerunners of the very high government advisor positions, such as the ministers of the right and left, Udaijin and Sadaijin, that would exist in the imperial court of later eras. Clan leaders beneath these top-tier clans were given a variety of other Kabane titles, such as Kimi, Atai, Miyatsuko, and Fuhito, among others, each with its own rank and duties. The heads of these clans, who directly served the Yamato administration, mostly in close proximity to the capital, though not always, were known as Tomo no Miyatsuko. In contrast to this, clans located further away from the nexus of government and entrusted with the management of the outlands were called Kuni no Miyatsuko, with Kuni meaning country or province. Many of these Kuni no Miyatsuko were native power holders who had been small-scale kings in the Yayoi period. In order to be approved by the Yamato government, they would gift all their lands to the great king as a display of fealty, and the king would then re-gift those same lands back to them and entrust them with their governance. Each Uji clan was not a monolith, but rather a hierarchical unit headed by a clan leader known as an Uji no Kami. Under the Uji no Kami were his relatives, called Ujibito, and together they formed the dominant layer of the clan. Below them were the Kakibe, basically ordinary people, subjects of the clan who engaged in farming and other forms of labor on clan-controlled lands. These lands, by the way, were known as Tadokoro. The Kakibe were not permitted to leave the domain of their Ujibito masters, but they possessed a certain degree of freedom in their daily lives, having their own homes and choosing their marriage partners freely within their class. The Tadokoro lands and the Kakibe laborers formed the economic backbone of an Uji clan. At the very bottom of the Uji hierarchy were the Nuhi, slaves who directly labored in the households and estates of the Uji no Kami and Ujibito, and were treated as their personal property. Taken all together, the Uji no Kami, Ujibito, Kakibe, and Nuhi composed a single Uji clan. The royal family also had its own personal lands called Miyake all throughout the kingdom. These lands were managed by the outland clans, the Kuni no Miyatsuko, but they were the direct property and economic base of the great king's family. During the 5th and 6th centuries, the royal court was forced to put down several rebellions by outland lords, and it set up more Miyake lands in these regions to strengthen its hold over them. The Miyake lands were inhabited by their own set of laborers, who were naturally the direct subjects of the royal family. These people were not called Kakibe, like the subjects of non-royal clans were, but were rather broken down into several categories depending on their profession. Those who engaged in farming were called Koshiro, Nashiro, and Tabe, and those who engaged in non-farming labor were called Shinabe. Those of you who study Japanese may be aware that Shina is the word for goods or items in the modern language. The Shinabe were then further broken down based on their specific roles into categories such as stable hands, Umakaibe, scribes, Fuhitobe, smiths, Kanuchibe, weavers, Nishikoribe, and potters, Suetsukuribe. You may have noticed that be is the common component of virtually all words related to the labor class and their duties, and indeed the catch-all term for these people, regardless of their jurisdiction, was bemin, sometimes also read as benotami. The gozoku of the Kofun period lived in sprawling yashiki residences encompassing multiple compounds and surrounded by moats, but the common laborers continued to live much as they had in the Yayoi period. One new advancement in living conditions, however, was the introduction of the kamado stove from China. This earthen stove was built into the walls of late Kofun period residences and replaced the fire pit of earlier eras and made cooking somewhat more convenient. One of the biggest technological innovations of the early Kofun period was the introduction of iron and its use in farming tools, such as hoes, spades, and sickles for harvesting rice. The religious devotion to nature from previous eras carried on into the Kofun period as well, and religious events such as the Kinensai, a spring festival praying for a bountiful harvest, and the Ninamesai, a fall festival thanking the gods for said harvest, became cultural fixtures. Superstition-based events and rituals, such as exorcisms, purifications, and divination rituals, were also taken quite seriously in this era. Some of these divination rituals included burning the bones of deer and interpreting the ashes, and an extreme one called kukatachi, which involved dunking one's hand in boiling water and interpreting the scarring. Shrines to the gods of nature, as well as to the family guardian gods of the various clans, began to be built all throughout the Yamato government's territory, and the various regional gods of Japan were slowly incorporated into the royal family's personal mythology to create a standardized narrative. The greatest cultural trademark of the period, however, is obviously the vast array of aforementioned Kofun tumuli, which, despite originating in the Yamato heartland, eventually spread all across the Japanese archipelago as outland gozoku were absorbed into the Yamato government's cultural and administrative sphere. The tombs, which have been found as far north as Iwate Prefecture, often made use of natural geography and were constructed on top of hills overlooking settlements or rice fields in places where they could easily be seen both by native subjects and foreign visitors. The largest of these tumuli are the keyhole-shaped mounds known in Japanese as Zenpo Koenfun, literally front square, back round tombs, but entirely circular or entirely rectangular tombs also exist. Two famed examples of the large keyhole-shaped style are the Daisen Kofun in Sakai City, Osaka Prefecture, and the Goshikizuka Kofun in Hyogo Prefecture. The former, at 460,000 square meters, boasts more than twice the area of the Great Pyramid of Giza, and it is estimated that it likely would have taken about 4 years to construct, even if 1,000 workers were mobilized every day. The latter, which faces out into the Seto Inland Sea from the city of Kobe, has actually been restored to its original appearance and reminds us that the Kofun tumulus mounds of ancient times were elegant stone-paved monuments rather than the overgrown forest islands that we know today. Due to the massive amount of manpower that was required to build the Kofun, we can surmise that the Yamato government and its great kings held a very strong degree of authority over their lands and subjects. Moreover, the technical savvy necessary to produce a finished tumulus that was well-balanced and symmetrical indicates that the builders possessed fairly advanced construction technology as well. We can also learn a great deal about the lifestyle and culture of the Kofun-era Japanese from decorations and burial items both in and outside the tombs. One particularly characteristic feature of the Kofun tumuli were little ceramic statues called haniwa that were placed all around the perimeter of the mounds. While they served the functional purpose of helping to prevent disintegration of the mounds, they were very decorative in appearance and often took the form of things like soldiers, houses, boats, and horses. Horses, by the way, were brought over to Japan from Korea during this period, and they were an elite status symbol which only the most influential and wealthy individuals could afford to possess. The Ōzuka Kofun in Fukuoka Prefecture is well known for its vibrant wall paintings in which an assortment of black and red horses are depicted standing amongst various colorful patterns. Within a Kofun tomb itself, the interred individual was buried with objects such as mirrors, armor and weapons such as swords, horse riding gear, farming implements, and jewelry such as earrings and kama-shaped magatama beads. It's probably no coincidence that the Sanshu no Jingi, the three Japanese imperial treasures comprising the Yata no Kagami mirror, the Yasakani no Magatama jewel, and the Kusanagi no Tsurugi sword are all the same variety of items that were being buried with the kings and aristocrats of the Kofun period. Tumuli from the early part of the period featured vertical entry stone tomb chambers called Tateanashiki Sekishitsu, but these were later replaced by horizontal entry chambers called Yokoanashiki Sekishitsu. Additionally, the burial goods themselves changed over the centuries, with early tombs leaning more towards ritualistic items such as the mirrors and Magatama beads, and the later tombs containing more militaristic items such as the horse equipment and armor. This illustrates the change in perception throughout the period of what an ideal leader ought to be, moving away from the Yayoi-era shaman rulers and towards the concept of a king as military leader. The Kofun period was also an age of great change on the Asian mainland, and especially in the Korean peninsula, where several powerful kingdoms began to emerge. At the beginning of the 4th century, the Manchuria and northern Korea-based kingdom of Goguryeo, known as Kokuri in Japanese, expanded its power further down south until it basically controlled the entire top half of the Korean peninsula. From the middle of the 4th century, the kingdom of Silla, Shiragi in Japanese, established its dominance in the southeast part of the peninsula, and the kingdom of Baekje, Kudara in Japanese, formed in the southwest. The southern tip of the peninsula remained a loose coalition of small independent states, which were collectively referred to by the Japanese as the Kaya region, or sometimes the Mimana region. The Yamato government chose this region as a prime spot to begin establishing inroads into the Korean peninsula, and by around the year 400 CE, they had used their foothold here to forge an alliance with the Baekje and begin fighting with the Goguryeo and the Silla. One of their prime goals in the Korean peninsula was the securement of sources of iron, which they processed in Japan but could not yet natively produce. The Nihon Shoki, Japan's semi-legendary history chronicle, actually mentions Japan having its own satellite administrative territory in the Kaya Mimana region, called the Mimana Nihonfu. But this is not corroborated by any other historical evidence and is thus thought to be no more than legend. The Yamato did, however, genuinely use this region as their doorway into Korea, and evidence of their very real and not-so-successful conflict with the Goguryeo is recorded on the Gwangeto Stele, a monument celebrating the deeds of the Goguryeo king Gwangeto, Kotayo in Japanese. This stele was erected in 414 and still stands in the modern Chinese city of Jian. Speaking of China, the Three Kingdoms period was ended in the year 280 CE with the unification of China proper by the Jin Dynasty. The Jin were plagued by infighting, however, and this, combined with the invasion of nomadic tribes from the north in the early 300s, led to their disintegration and eventual destruction in the year 420. This in turn heralded the beginning of China's Northern and Southern Dynasties period. For the first 60 years or so of this period, China's southern dynasty was the Song, and according to the Wakokuden section of their history record, the Book of Song, Sōjō in Japanese, five successive great kings of the Yamato government sent at least 9 separate tribute-bearing envoys to them during the 5th century. These five kings, known in Japanese as the Wa no Go-o, are recorded in the Book of Song under the names San, Qin, Se, Ko, and Bu, and scholars continue to debate over which of the legendary Japanese emperors from the Nihon Shoki these names correspond to. The consensus on the latter three is fairly unanimous. Se is thought to be the Emperor Ingyo, Ko is held to be Emperor Anko, and Bu is most likely Emperor Yuryaku. Opinions regarding San, however, are split between the emperors Ōjin, Nintoku, and Richū, and opinions on Qin are split between Nintoku and Hanze. Either way, these emperors, or kings of Yamato rather, were actively sending these envoys in an effort to gain recognition from the Song Emperor regarding their status as kings and the legitimacy of their holdings in the Korean peninsula. With the busy interaction between Japan, Korea, and China in the 5th century, a new wave of migration to Japan from the mainland began. These mainlanders, who often came over to the archipelago in entire clan units, are referred to in modern academia as Toraijin, literally people who cross and come over, and they brought with them a wide variety of new technologies and academic knowledge. Many of them came to Japan to flee the wars and famines ravaging the mainland due to the political instability in China and Korea at this time. The Yamato royal court actively welcomed them, directly employing quite a few in record-keeping or finance-related jobs within the government, and giving them their own kabane titles such as Obito, Fushito, and Suguri. Some Toraijin did not even come of their own free will, with captives of war and otherwise coerced individuals also being in the mix. The court referred to all these Toraijin newcomers as Kikajin, a word which superficially would seem to mean those who are naturalized. But for the court, it had a nuance, borrowed from Chinese thought, of a barbaric people encountering a virtuous king, seeing the light, if you will, and gratefully becoming that king's subjects. Because of this, while the term Kikajin is still taught as the Yamato government's name for these people, the aforementioned Toraijin is the official academic term that has been adopted in today's textbooks to refer to them. Technologies brought to Japan during this period by the Toraijin include irrigation, embankment, and reservoir construction techniques, blacksmithing, shipbuilding, and silk weaving crafts, and a new type of durable blackish pottery called sueki. You will recall that the goods producing Shinabe class of artisans ended up specializing in many of these new fields. The king of Baekje also sent two important literary works to the Yamato court as gifts at the beginning of the 5th century, the Rongo, aka the Analects of Confucius, and the Senjimon, otherwise known as the Thousand Character Classic, a 1,000-letter-long Chinese poem in which not a single Chinese character is ever repeated. With this gift from the king of Baekje, both the kanji writing system and the philosophy of Confucianism made their debut in Japan. We can see that the Japanese quickly adopted the new writing system, using it to send diplomatic documents and engrave objects such as mirrors and swords. One such example is the iron sword excavated from the Inariyama Kofun in Saitama, whose golden letters describe how its bearer served the great king Wakatakeru, thought to be Bu, aka Emperor Yureku, the last of the aforementioned five kings, in the late 5th century. Apparently not yet satisfied with altering the course of Japanese history, Baekje went on to send the Yamato court a Buddhist statue about a century later. And although there would be considerable quarreling over whether to adopt the new religion, this point in time does mark the official transmission of Buddhism to Japan. Two theories exist regarding the exact year of this event, but the leading theory is that it occurred in 538, and this year has its own fun mnemonic for Japanese students to remember it by. The mnemonic is Kudara no Hotoke ni go sanpai, which means worship the Buddha of Baekje. Kudara, as you may recall, is the Japanese word for Baekje. Hotoke means Buddha, and go sanpai is the word sanpai, meaning worship, with an honorific go attached to it. Go, however, beyond being an honorific prefix, is also the pronunciation for the Japanese number 5. Sanpai then gives us the subsequent 3 and 8, with san being the Japanese pronunciation for the number 3 and 8. Well, let's get into 8. 8 in Japanese is hachi, but when Japanese words starting with a ha sound are attached to the ends of other words as suffixes, the ha often turns into a pa. One well-known example of this is hai, the counterword for cups, which, when attached to the number 1, ichi, yields the word ippai, meaning one cup. Because of this, it is quite easy for a Japanese speaker to associate the pai in sanpai with the sound ha, and thus mentally link it with the number 8, hachi. To sum it all up, we have go sanpai equals go san hai equals go san hachi equals 538, 538 CE. Whew. Hope you're still with me. According to legend, when the Emperor Kinmei received this Buddhist statue, he called together his advisors and solicited their opinions regarding the new religion and whether or not they should adopt it. The man holding the post of Oomi at that time was Soga no Iname, a cosmopolitan man with many connections overseas in China and Korea, and he expressed his support for the adoption of Buddhism. On the other side of the aisle, however, was Mononobe no Okoshi, the man holding the post of Omuraji, who argued that adopting the Buddhist religion would anger the old gods of the islands of Japan. Torn between his two top advisors, Emperor Kinmei decided to simply entrust the Buddhist statue to Soga no Iname for the time being. Iname brought the statue back to his yashiki residence, which he then converted into a temple in which to worship and pray to the Buddha. Not long after, a devastating plague began to spread, killing many, and Mononobe no Okoshi argued to the emperor that this was proof that the gods had been angered. With the circumstances being such as they were, Emperor Kinmei felt that he had no choice but to accept Okoshi's assessment of the situation, and with the emperor's blessing, Okoshi burned Soga no Iname's temple to the ground and cast the Buddhist statue into a nearby river. From this point on, the Soga and Mononobe clans would be at each other's throats, and events would begin to be set in motion that would greatly affect the course of the history of Japan. The resolution to this conflict, however, will have to wait till next time, when we move into the Asuka period and meet the illustrious yet enigmatic Prince Shotoku, a man whose influence on his country persists to this day. As always, thanks for watching, have a great day, and
boom, Oinorizu.